Good morning, students. Myself, Dr. Raga Sudha, head and assistant professor, Department of Microbiology, Government City College, Hyderabad, is here with a new topic on types of immunity. From birth, we are exposed to a continuous stream of microorganisms that have the potential to wreak havoc on our bodily processes. Without effective protective mechanisms, each of us would soon succumb to diseases caused by microorganisms or to the harmful effects of foreign substances like toxins produced by various plants and bacteria. In the battle with microbial invaders, humans and other vertebrates protect themselves by a complex array of defensive measures collectively termed the immune system. The discipline of immunology grew out of the observations that individuals who have recovered from certain infectious diseases were thereafter protected from the disease. The Latin term immunis, meaning exempt, is the source of English word immunity, meaning the state of protection from infectious diseases. Immunity means freedom from burden. It's an ability of an organism to recognize and defend itself against specific pathogens or antigens. Perhaps the earliest written reference for the phenomenon of immunity can be tracked back to Thucydides, the great historian of Peloponnesian War. In describing a plague in Athens, he wrote in 430 BC that only those who have recovered from the plague could nurse the sick because they would not contract the disease a second time. All the early associations recognized the phenomenon of immunity. Almost 2000 years passed before the concept was successfully converted into a medically effective practice. Immune response. It is a third line of defense involved in production of antibodies and generation of specialized lymphocytes against specific antigen. Well, what is antigen? Antigen are molecules from a pathogen or foreign organism that provoke a specific immune response. The immune system is a third line of defense against infection. The defense mechanism of an individual can be classified into two types, non-specific defense mechanism and specific defense mechanism. Non-specific defense mechanism is in turn classified into two types, first line defense mechanism and second line defense mechanism. The first line of defense comprises of skin and mucous membrane and their secretions, while the second line of defense includes phagocytic white blood cells, antimicrobial proteins, inflammatory response. The specific defense mechanism called the third line of defense involves lymphocytes and antibodies. Now moving on to types of immunity. Immunity, the state of protection from infectious diseases, has both non-specific and specific components. The non-specific component is known as innate immunity or genetic immunity. It is a set of disease-resistant mechanisms that are not specific to a particular pathogen. Innate immunity is the immunity an organism is born with. It is genetically determined and may be due to lack of receptors or other molecules required for infection. Example for innate immunity is human immunity to canine distemper. Another example is immunity of mice to polio virus. This non-specific immunity or innate immunity is comprised of four barriers: anatomic barriers, physiological barriers, phagocytic barriers and inflammatory barriers. Anatomic barriers are also known as physical barriers that tend to prevent the entry of pathogen or an organism's first line of defense against infection. Skin and the surface of mucous membrane are included in this category because they are effective barriers to the entry of most of the microorganisms. Picture of human skin structure. The skin consists of two distinct layers. The epidermis, a thin layer. Thin outer layer is known as epidermis. Thick layer is known as dermis. The epidermis contains several layers of tightly packed epithelial cells. The outer epidermal layer consists of dead cells and it is filled with waterproofing protein called keratin. The dermis, which is composed of connective tissue, contains blood vessels, hair follicles, sebaceous glands and sweat glands or sweat pores. The sebaceous glands are associated with the hair follicles and produce a oily secretion called sebum. Sebum consists of lactic and fatty acids which maintain the pH of the skin between 3 to 5. This pH inhibits the growth of most microorganisms. A few bacteria that metabolize sebum live as commensals on the skin and sometimes cause a severe form of acne. Moving on to the mucous membrane. The mucous membrane is comprised of mucus and cilia. This is the picture of mucus lining of the lungs. Normal flora compete with microbes for attachment sites and nutrients. The mucus entraps the foreign molecules while cilia propel the microorganisms out of the body. Next, moving on to physiological barriers. The physiological barriers that contribute to innate immunity include temperature, pH and various soluble factors. Many species are not susceptible to certain diseases simply because their normal body temperature inhibits growth of pathogens. Chickens, for example, have innate immunity to anthrax because their high body temperature inhibits the growth of the bacteria. Gastric acid is an innate physiologic barrier to infection because very few ingested microorganisms can survive the low pH of the stomach contents. One reason newborns are susceptible to some diseases that do not afflict adults is that their stomach contents are less acidic than that of adults. A variety of soluble factors contribute to non-specific immunity. Among them, the soluble protein lysozyme, interferon and complement. Lysozyme, a hydrolytic enzyme found in the mucus, secretions mucus and in tears. It is able to cleave the peptidoglycan layer of the bacterial cell wall. Similarly, interferons comprises a group of proteins produced by virus-infected cells. Among the many functions of interferons is the ability to bind to nearby cells and induce a generalized antiviral state. While complement is a group of serum proteins that circulate in an inactivate state, a variety of specific and non-specific immunological mechanisms can convert the inactive form of complement proteins into an active state that enable them to damage the membranes of the pathogenic organisms, either destroying the pathogens or facilitating their clearance. Next, moving on to phagocytic barriers. It is another important innate defense mechanism which involves in ingestion of extracellular particulate matters by phagocytosis. Phagocytosis is a type of endocytosis in which the general term for uptake by a cell of material from its environment. Phagocytosis is the ingestion of particulate matter which may include whole pathogenic organism. In phagocytosis, a cell's plasma membrane expands around the particulate matter material to form large vacuole called phagosome. Most phagocytosis is conducted by specialized cells such as blood monocytes, neutrophils, and tissue macrophages. Most cell types are capable of other forms of endocytosis, such as receptor mediated endocytosis, wherein extracellular molecules are internalized after binding by specific cellular receptors, and pinocytosis, by which cell takes up fluids from the surrounding media and any molecule containing in it. Next, moving on to the fourth innate barrier, inflammatory barrier. When a tissue is damaged by a wound or by invasion of a pathogenic microorganism, it induces a complex sequence of events collectively known as inflammatory response. Many of the classic features of the inflammatory response were described as early as 1600 BC in Egyptian papyrus writings. In the 1st century AD, the Roman physician Celsus described the four cardinal signs of inflammation, namely rubor stands for redness, tumor means swelling, calor means heat, and dolor means pain. In 2nd century AD, another physician Galen added a fifth sign, function, lysa means loss of function. The cardinal signs of inflammation reflect three major events of an inflammatory response. Here in the picture, we can see the bacteria and other pathogens, when they are entering the wound, platelets from the blood release blood clot proteins at the wound site. The mast cells secrete factors that mediate vasodilation and vascular constriction. Delivery of blood, plasma, and cells to injured area increases, while neutrophils secrete factors that kill and degrade the pathogen. Neutrophils and macrophages remove pathogens by phagocytosis, and macrophages secrete hormones called cytokines that attract immune system cells to the site and activate cells involved in tissue repair. Inflammatory response continues until the foreign material is eliminated and the wound is repaired. So, the major three events of inflammatory response are, first one is vasodilation, which involves an increase in the diameter of the blood vessel of the nearby capillaries, occurs as the vessels that carry blood away from the affected area constrict, resulting in engorgement of the capillary network. The engorged capillaries are responsible for tissue redness or erythema and an increase in tissue temperature. The second major event of an inflammatory response is increase in capillary permeability, facilitating influx of fluid and cells from the engorged capillaries into the tissue. The fluid that accumulates has a much higher protein content than fluid normally releases from the vasculature. Accumulation of exudates contribute to the tissue swelling or edema. The third major event of inflammatory response is influx of phagocytes from the capillaries into the tissue and is facilitated by increased capillary permeability. The emigration of phagocytes is a complex series of events, including adherence of the cells to the endothelial walls of the blood vessels called migration, followed by their emigration between the capillary endothelial cells into the tissue known as extravasation, and finally their migration through the tissue to the site of the inflammatory response, migrates to the inflammatory response. As phagocytic cells accumulate at the site and begin to phagocytose bacteria, they release lytic enzymes which can damage nearby healthy cells. The accumulation of dead cells digests the material and fluid forms a substance called pus. Next, moving on to the second type of immunity called adaptive immunity or acquired immunity or specific immunity. This is capable of recognizing and selectively eliminate specific foreign microorganisms and molecules. Unlike innate immunity response, acquired immunity reacts to specific antigen challenges and display four characteristic attributes like antigenic specificity, diversity, immunological memory, self or non-self recognition. So this is the immunity that an organism develops during lifetime, and it is not genetically determined, may be acquired naturally or artificially. Development of immunity to measles in response to infection or vaccination is a good example. Let's see some of the components of the immune system. The immune system bears certain components called adenoid, tonsils, lymph nodes, thoracic duct, thymus, spleen, lymphatic vessels, and bone marrow. Acquired immunity is classified into two major types: naturally acquired immunity and artificially acquired immunity. Naturally acquired immunity is the immunity obtained in course of daily life. Naturally acquired immunity is in turn classified into two types: naturally acquired active immunity and naturally acquired passive immunity. Naturally acquired active immunity is the immunity given by antigens or obtained by when an antigen or a pathogen enters body naturally. The body generates an immune response to the antigen. Immunity may be long life, as in case of chickenpox or mumps, or temporary, as in case of influenza or intestinal infections. While naturally acquired passive immunity, in this, antibodies are passed from mother to fetus via placenta or breastfeeding in the form of colostrum. No immune response to the antigens. The immunity is usually short-lived for weeks or 2 months. The protection to the child is until the child's immune system is developed. Next, moving on to the second type of acquired immunity called artificially acquired immunity. It is obtained by receiving a vaccine or immune serum. Artificially acquired immunity is in turn of two types: artificially acquired active immunity and artificially acquired passive immunity. In artificially acquired active immunity, in the form of vaccines or immunization, the body generates an immune response to the antigen. The immunity can be for lifelong, as in oral polio vaccine, or temporary, as in case of tetanus toxoid. In case of artificially acquired passive immunity, performed antibodies or anti-sera are introduced into the body by injection. Example, snake anti-venom injection from horses or rabbits. The immunity is short-lived, half-life for 3 weeks. Host immune system does not respond to the antigen. Let us see some of the meanings of this in this video. Serum stands for fluid that remains after blood has clotted and cells have been removed. Anti-serum, serum containing antibodies to a specific antigen obtained from injecting an animal like horse, rabbit, or goat with antigens like snake venom, botulism, or diphtheria toxin. Serology, the study of reactions between antibodies and antigens, is known as serology. Gamma globulins, fraction of serum that contains most of the antibodies. Serum sickness, the disease caused by multiple injections of the anti-serum. Immune response to foreign proteins may cause fever, kidney problems, and joint pains. Rare today. Duality of the immune system. Although Pasteur proved that vaccination worked, he did not understand how. The experimental work of Emil von Behring and Shibasabu Kitaso in 1890 gave the first insight into the mechanism of immunity, earning von Behring the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 1901. Von Behring and Kitasato demonstrated that serum from animals previously immunized to diphtheria could transfer the immune state to unimmunized animals. In search of the protective agent, various research during the next decade demonstrated that an active component from immune serum could neutralize toxins, precipitate toxins, and agglutinate bacteria. In each case, the active agent was named for the activity it exhibited, like antitoxin, precipitin, and agglutinin respectively. Initially, a different serum component was thought to be responsible for each activity, but during 1930s, mainly through the effect of Elvin Cabot, a fraction of serum, first called gamma globulin, was shown to be responsible for all these activities. The active molecule in the immunoglobulin fraction are called antibodies, because immunity was mediated by antibodies contained in the body fluids. It was called humoral immunity. In due course, a controversy developed between those who held the concept of humoral immunity and those who agreed with Metchnikoff's concept of cell-mediated immunity, which includes phagocytosis of the cells. It was difficult to study the activity of immune cells before the development of modern tissue culture techniques, whereas studies with serum took advantage of establishing biochemical tests. In a key experiment in 1940s, Merrill Chase succeeded in transferring immunity to the tuberculosis organisms by transferring white blood cells between guinea pigs. This demonstration helped to rekindle interest in cellular immunity. With the emergence of improved cell culture techniques in 1950s, the lymphocytes were identified as a cell responsible for both cellular and humoral immunity. Thus, the duality of the immune system has been established during 1950s by showing that the immune system exhibits two modes of immunity: humoral immunity and cell-mediated immunity. Humoral immunity is the immunity which is mediated by antibodies. It involves production of antibodies against foreign agents. The antibodies are produced by a subset of lymphocytes called B cells. The B cells that are stimulated will actively secrete antibodies and are called plasma cells. Antibodies are found in extracellular fluids like blood, plasma, lymph, mucus, etc., and on the surface of the B cells. Defense against bacteria, bacterial toxins, and viruses that circulate freely in the body before they enter the cells also cause certain reactions against transplanted tissues. Antibodies are produced by B lymphocytes, which is known as proliferation of B cells or B lymphocytes. The main source of these antibodies is bone marrow or fetal liver in case of fetus. Bone marrow comprises of pluripotent stem cells. These pluripotent stem cells are transferred to the lymphocytes, transform into stem cells. These stem cells which develop in the lymphocytes are known as B cells. B cells are transferred or circulated in the lymphatic tissue, which include lymph nodes, spleen, blood, and lymph. Structure of antibody. Antibodies are made up of four chains, four amino acid chains, two long chains and two short chains, which in turn are bound by disulfide bonds. These antibodies comprises of antigen binding sites. The antigen binding site is the site where the epitope of the antigen comes and bind at the region to form an interaction or a complex between the antigen and the antibody. The consequence of antibody binding to an antigen results in four types of reactions. First one is neutralization, which blocks viral binding sites, coats bacteria, or by opsonization. The second one is agglutination of the antigen bearing particles such as microbes. Third is precipitation of soluble antigen. Fourth is complex fixation or activation of the complement, which leads to cell lysis. Neutralization, agglutination, and precipitation enhances phagocytosis by macrophages. Moving on to the second type of immune system, cell-mediated immune system. It involves specialized set of lymphocytes called T cells that recognize foreign antigen on the surface of cell organisms or tissues. It involves two types of cells, helper T cells and cytotoxic T cells. T cells regulate proliferation and activity of other cells of the immune systems like B cells, macrophages, neutrophils, etc. It acts as a defense against bacteria and viruses that are inside host cells and are inaccessible to antibodies, fungi, protozoa, helminths, cancer cells and transplanted tissues are being affected by the cell mediated immunity or T cells. Proliferation of T cells or cell mediated immunity is carried by T lymphocytes. The proliferation of T lymphocytes begins with the bone marrow or fetal liver containing the pluripotent stem cells, which are transferred to the lymphocytes, and from lymphocytes the stem cells are transferred to in the form of T cells to the thymus cells. In thymus cells they develop into T cells. These T cells, mature T cells, circulate in the lymphatic tissue, in the tissues like lymph nodes, spleen, blood and lymph. Thank you.